When I was reading the works of Sri Aurobindo and Mother, I mean, companionship and love, of course, such essentials of our lives, which I've not been a success at so
No,
far.
wait, wait, wait. May I just interject?
Yeah.
The essential is truth. Companionship is not essential. Right? If companionship is a hurdle in the way of truth, you better do away with the companion.
I did away with the companion.
Companionship is not the final thing. The final thing is something else. The companion has to be a medium towards that thing. Otherwise, the companion is toxic. So, companionship, even love is not essential. What is essential is truth. I know many people would be hurt by this. Love is not essential. When you say love is essential, then you get into love of the totally wrong kind. Because you have taken love as the final thing, then attraction and sensuousness and attachment, they become the names of love. So love is not essential. What is essential is being attracted towards someone who elevates you. If your love is of that kind, wonderful. Otherwise, the essential thing, the central thing, what is essential is something without which you cannot exist. That's called essential. Essence means core. Essence means self, Atma. Essence means the truth. So only the truth can be essential. Nothing else is essential. If love takes you truth, love is fine. If love is a bar against the truth, love is not fine.
Correct.
Yeah, please continue.
Yeah. So when I was reading their work, there was this thing that I came across which was really thought-provoking for me. They spoke about, Sri Aurobindo spoke about, he spoke about three levels or three kinds of partnerships, if you can call them. He said there's one at the vital level, vital partnership, there is psychic partnership, and then there is spiritual partnership. So my question is, how do I find the spiritual partner, and how do I know or recognize?
Just the same way you find the right guru. Go back to that question.
Okay, the authenticity in my core.
You must know what you are seeking from the person. If you get it from that person, you are with the right person.
What are you looking for? What are you seeking?
If you are just looking for decent looks and somebody to accompany you to the movies, then anybody would do. But if you're looking really to not to make a waste of your life, and if you're looking to someone who just refreshes you, gives you freedom from all the stillness we carry within from all these centuries, then you will find the right person. What are you looking for? So, the right partner is not determined by the attributes of the partner. The right partner is determined and achieved by the intensity of your hunger, your inquiry. Just as I said, you go and ask the right questions from the guru, and if the guru comes a cropper, you leave. Similarly, even with your partner, you need to ask certain questions. Maybe not in the same way you formally inquire from a guru, but the essence of the question has to be the same because the essence of the suffering is the same. Are you a different person in front of the teacher and a different one in front of the partner? No, that's not the same, right? So the suffering consciousness is the same. Even when you are in with your with, irrespective of who you are with actually. Mother, father, your dog, your cat, the purpose has to be one. The purpose is I have to be better. Not in the sense of earning more money. I have to be better inwardly. I have to come out of this inner haze. Does my dog help me with that? You have to be austere and rigorous to that extent. I know many people would hear this and laugh, that does even a dog need to be measured on a spiritual yardstick? Yes, of course. Why must you keep a pet?
I get it. Huh?
If the pet is going to make your life hell. Every single thing that you do, you must ask, is it going to liberate me from my bondages and my ignorance? Why must I wear a ring? Why must I wear an earring? Why must I comb my hair this way? Why must I take a walk to the shop? Why must I breathe? Why must I wake up every morning? Why must I do that? The purpose has to be liberation, and one has to be absolutely one-minded on that. No wavering, no second thoughts. I know why I exist, because I know how I exist. Once you know how you exist, you know why you exist. How do you exist? You exist in agony, and therefore, why do you exist? You exist for liberation. Are you with me? So, it's not a complicated question at all. Men, women, all have this question, and it has been romanticized endlessly, and it has been turned into something mysterious, as they say these days, mystical. How can you know whether the heavens have really chosen that particular face for you? The heavens have chosen nothing. Your angst has to choose its doctor. But that's so unromantic. Am I supposed to choose a doctor? I mean, come on. I'm looking to visit a discotheque, not a hospital. Right? I want to go to Switzerland, and you are sending me to Apollo hospitals. Why do you talk of the partner as a doctor? But the partner has to be a doctor, because you are
a patient.
You are sick, and you don't want to acknowledge that because you are pretty. I'm so handsome. I'm so tall. How can I call myself a patient? You are a patient. Better have some humility and acknowledge that.
Yeah.
And then you will know the one to partner. Otherwise, you will be in all kinds of wrong relationships.
And they come in the garb of the promise initially, but then it all comes off,
Promises anybody can make. The thing is, if I really want something, I'll test the promise, no? Are those promises ever validated? Do we pass them through scrutiny? No, we don't. Why? Well, we have not bothered. Not bothered. I may write there that I'm very concerned about me not getting infected. But am I even bothering to ask that person, sir, are you vaccinated? Sir, are you vaccinated? I don't even bother to ask that person whether he is vaccinated. And I keep telling myself, I care so much about my health and public health in general. So all these are games we play with ourselves. We tell ourselves one thing, whereas we live a totally different thing. It's not others that deceive us. We keep deceiving ourselves endlessly. And the funny thing is, when we discover that others too have deceived us, we cry ourselves dry. How can you complain now? The very name of the game was deception. He was deceiving you. You were deceiving him or her. He was deceiving himself, and you were deceiving yourself. All kinds of permutations, combinations in deception were happening all the time. Now that something has come up, you are crying. Explain.
So once you've gone through you know, the path of obviously stumbling down and then discovering who you are. Even after that, there are, I mean, it is happening. So they will pop up, right? In the garb of looking in the sense, not looking right. Mm. I mean, we are obviously not that shallow anymore. So looking in the sense, oh, all like they're all deeper than that see. So how do you spot a lie?
Does an infected person look different from a normal person?
No.
Do you do? You test.
Mm.
Hmm? Always carry RT-PCR kits with you. Keep testing. Mm. By the looks, you will never know whether the fellow is infected or not.
Mm.
You must test. And how will you test?
Mm.
Through your own angst, through your own inquiry.
So is there no depth left in the men anymore? I mean, what? What is the game? Predominantly.
If there is no depth left in the men, and women are usually unable to see that, is there any depth left in women either? Had there been, I am generalizing, but let's play this game.
Hmm.
If there is no depth in the man, and the woman still falls prey to the man, what kind of depth does the woman have?
Hmm. Correct.
That's the utility of depth. You don't fall prey to shallowness. Without the real thing, nothing in life falls in the right place. At times, we might be deluded into thinking that things are going well with us. They cannot. They cannot. Even if it is happening, it is going to be very short-lived and the end is going to be tragic. You can happily run your car on a flat tire for 2 kilometers. And then you can have a powerful steering. We have power steerings these days, and the engine is very powerful, 200 horsepower, and you are an insensitive driver, so you don't quite notice the vibrations in the vehicle. For 2 kilometers, you can happily run the vehicle even at 60 or 80 miles an hour with a flat tire. That's all. And then when somebody calls you up or gestures from outside, hey, you're such a fool. He's unnecessarily raising a scene. All these are conspiracy theorists. I am so happily riding my vehicle and the fellow is warning me from there and playing it up. They don't like my happiness. That's what so many people verbally or non-verbally say to me. They may not say that, but it's writ large on their faces. And we are so happy, probably don't like our happiness. I want you to be really happy. I know the thing that you call as happiness. I know how deceptive it is and what kind of pain it would leave you with. Therefore, I'm warning you against false happiness. I'm not an enemy of happiness. I don't like this movement into deeper and deeper pain in the name of happiness. But personal problem, social problem, global problem. There is just one problem. Unless we address that, we can have 1,000 names to 1,000 problems. And it's very easy to address that and very difficult to address that. Because that problem is not outside of us, that problem is within us. That problem lies in our very build. So it's easy because the problem is near, it's difficult because the problem is within.
You know, in this book that I read, David Epstein, it did quite well actually. It's called Generalists, Why Generalists Triumph in a Specialized World. So, there are so many things, many times one is endowed with. Like, personally for me, I'm drawn to a lot of stuff. So basically, do I do it all? Is it possible to do it all?
I'm drawn towards all the stuff in the pharmacist's place.
Okay, I got it. Yeah. Which medicine do you?
Which sickness do you?
Which medicine you use to treat your sickness, basically?
Yeah. First thing is acknowledgement of the sickness.
Oh.
That decides the medicine, and that then rejects all the needless medication. Needless medication is very close to more sickness, no? All that in ignorance of the real disease.
I was talking more work-wise in the sense, there's music, there are a lot of things, so even...
Doesn't matter, all these are objects.
Okay.
In our sensory world. We need to know who we are and therefore what is it that suits us. Skill-wise, at points in my life, I have been good at certain sports. I have been good at mathematics, I have been good at engineering, I have been good at management. I have been good at acting. What is it that I need to do? It's just not that I feel talented in some space, so I take that space up.
Amazing.
Talent is such a foolish thing. I would have probably made a good physicist. Is that the need of my consciousness?
Wow, this is good.
Even today, if there is one thing that attracts me beyond Vedant, it's physics. I even taught physics. And data analytics. But is that where my real need lies? Is that where the sickness of the world lies?
What does the world need?
If I become a physicist, that's not going to heal the world. We already have enough physicists. Concerned with this question are the words of passion, calling, and all such things, no? But I feel so passionate about what? Let's say, give me something.
Singing.
Singing. Yeah. Now, there's hardly anybody who does not feel passionate about singing. But hello. I'm not against singing. Anybody in India who is not passionate about cricket? 74.6% India wants to get into the national cricket team.
Yeah. Either cricket or acting or singing.
Yeah. Those who cannot make it to the Wankhede Stadium want to make it to the studios. Either the stadium or the studio. So that pretty much covers the entire population of the country. Hello. Two hoots to passion. You see what you must do, not what you are inclined to do. Being born in India, obviously you would be inclined to take the ball or the bat in hand. I too was inclined. That's not what I'm going to do.
Or perhaps use your singing in a way that it is conducive now, to serve the purpose.
Now, that makes sense.
What sort of songs then again, are you singing?
But again, you have to determine if your songs are just a means towards some higher end, then are songs the best means towards that end? If the end is the important thing, then are the songs the best means? If they are, continue with singing. If they are not, pick that up which would be most efficient in taking you towards your goal. So,
but Meera sang bhajans of Krishnaji too.
Meera succeeded with songs in reaching Krishna. Not everybody succeeded with songs in reaching Krishna. You have to ask yourself, is Krishna important or the songs? The answer would be Krishna, if you are honest. If Krishna is important, are songs the best way? If the answer is yes, continue with singing. If the answer is no, don't deceive yourself. Pick some other way. If you persist with singing, irrespective of knowing that this is not taking you to Krishna, then singing is more important for you than Krishna. And that's bad.
I like it, lovely.
Were Meera asked to pick between her bhajans and Krishna, what would she choose?
Krishna.
Bhajans were good for her only because they were 100% aligned with her love for Krishna. Bhajans are secondary, Krishna is primary.